Welcome to Snowmobiler Television. On today's episode, our test riders will take out some 2015 two-up sleds. The folks at Triton Trailers will go over the latest in trailer technology, and the folks at Kimpex show us how to stay warm in the cold.
STV is sponsored by Yamaha, revs your heart. Kimpex, fueled by fun. And by Skidoo, never stop pushing.
Touring sleds have come a long way from the 80s and 90s when really all you had was an extended seat and hopefully a strap for the person to hang on so they didn't fall off the back. Today's touring sleds are pure luxury. Lots of heat, lots of wind protection, lots of luxury. So that all said, we also threw a couple other sleds into the mix today just to jazz it up a little bit, if you will. So let's go see what the test riders have to say about the ultimate in luxury touring sleds.
Skidoo Grand Touring 1200 with the 4TEC today we head out, and for me it's the BMW of snowmobiles. And for 2015, BRP has put the silent drive on the Grand Touring with the 1200 motor. And if you haven't rode a sled with silent drive, you really owe it to yourself. Zero track noise, so you don't hear that whining, that noise. This sled is like a Swiss watch. It's just beautiful. And air ride, R motion, 1200 four cylinder 4TEC engine. You can adjust the ride height on it straight from the handlebars. It's got an onboard little air compressor. It pumps up the shock, so you can set it to whatever level you want depending on how many passenger weight you have on it. Just a really nice snowmobile to ride. You can ride it all day, pull your helmet off, and your ears aren't ringing. Tons of wind protection, and it goes really well. It's just, it is the top of the line snowmobile on the snow today.
New for 2015 for Articat is the Pantera 7000. We're riding the base model today. It comes in the base or limited. The limited gets the extra saddlebags and deluxe gauge and little things like that. This is a all-new sled. It's based on the Pro Tour chassis, so it's pretty close to the Pro Cross. It gets a different tunnel. Has a 146 rear suspension, which is pretty much the same as what was in the previous TZ1, which is a good thing because that's one of the best touring suspensions on the market, and actually one of the best just riding suspensions in general on the market. It's extremely stable, so its corner is very flat, and you can actually ride the sled really aggressive. That was one of the things the designers wanted to make sure they didn't lose the fun, that you could actually go out and whether riding two up or one up, you could actually ride aggressive. And you know, it's got similar shock calibrations to that of the XF sport models, so it'll take the bumps and it'll handle quick corners and hard cornering, which is nice because, I mean, it's a snowmobile, you still want to have fun on it. You don't always go in a straight line with two people on it.
The Adventure also is in the new Axis chassis. Same color graphics as last year in 2014, but 2015 it comes in the new Axis chassis. Fantastic ride, fantastic handling. You get the luggage rack, luggage bags on the side with the inside liners that you can bring into the motel room at night. So all the goodness the Switchback has been known for. It's the original adventure on off-road snowmobile, and Polaris has, I guess, defined that category or created it, you know, based on the KTM type motorcycle adventure bikes that are really popular in the summertime. And for 2015, with the Axis chassis, it's just 100 times better. That's all I can say. You have to ride it to believe it.
So we rode the 2015 SR Viper STX DX. It's a new model for 2015. This is for the adventure touring market. It's got a nice rack on the back where you can add extra accessory bags, that kind of thing. It's got the heavy duty bumper on the back. You can add accessory two-up seat, which is nice as a first for Yamaha. Comes with a large windshield, the tuner skis, and the biggest feature on the machine is the 141-inch long track. It's a Cobra track, 1.352 lugs, but it's an uncoupled suspension, so it's not going to ride as well as the LTX that has the 137 coupled suspension. You're going to get a lot more weight transfer out of it. It's going to definitely pivot more in the corners, so it takes a different riding style, but once you get off trail and you want to do a bit of exploring, you're going to like that uncoupled suspension. When you want to get on the gas, it's going to lift those skis off the snow, let that machine get, maneuver around a little easier. So, we've put miles on the suspension before. It's no different, in the STX version, and it's going to be a good machine for Yamaha, and it's a good all-round machine. It's not a great riding trail machine, but it's great. You know, it's pretty good off trail, and it'll handle actually quite a bit of powder as we found out this year, so it's pretty comfortable and lots of wind protection and carries all your gear as well.
Sleds have sure evolved over the years, and so has the manner in which we haul those sleds around. Gone are the days of adapted utility trailers. Today, the equipment is much better. Craig Nicholson, the Intrepid Snowmobiler, sat down with Paul McNichol from Triton Trailers to go over the latest in their technology.
So Paul, the first question is, how long has Triton been in the trailer business, and why do they have such a good reputation?
Well, Triton were one of the original pioneers of the aluminum trailer market well over 25 years ago. So we've been distributing the product in Canada for over 20 years. And what Triton has done is they've come up with innovations that many competitors to this day still don't have. We've got things like tilt springs that assist in the trailer staying tilted with the snowmobiles on. They've got a molded wiring harness. Many of these components they did 20 years ago. And like I say, a lot of competitors still haven't got it. I think our main selling benefits is we're built with quality in mind, and that's our first and foremost thing. So in all the components, whether it's the lights, the wiring, the tires, even the bolts that hold the tires on, we've thought it out as what's gonna last the longest, what's the best for the job. By doing that, the product will last a long time. We like to say 15 years, a lot of them last longer than that. So in the big picture, over the long haul, the Triton will be the most economical to own because the resale value will remain high because people know they're a good trailer.
Your best-selling model, I think, is the model directly behind us. Do you want to tell us a little bit about what this is?
This is our clamshell tilting trailer, and basically what happens is 11 foot is the hot selling unit right now for any sleds, short track or long track, and for the most part the big door is a good working unit. We like to do ski guides, tilt spring, tongue jack on it. This gives it a very user-friendly ability that you can use it and not have any issues.
I've actually, as most people have done, I think, I started out with the enclosed trailer we just talked about, and then with a little arm twisting from you, which worked out very well for me, moved up to the TC118, which is what is behind us. Now, do you want to talk a little bit about it and kind of why it's kind of the next logical progression from the one we just talked about and what you get for this that's over and above the base model?
I think what's happened over the years is we all started with an open deck trailer. We moved into the clamshell because it was nicer to use, and now the hybrids bring another level. You don't have to worry about the snow load on the roof of the trailer to getting the lid lifted up. Driving up a ramp door is a lot easier than driving up a tilted trailer. So these things actually make your life easier and make the whole experience more enjoyable. Our natural progression in the automotive industry is power windows and air conditioning and leather seats. So now this is the progression in the trailer industry to make my life easier, make it work better. And the nice thing is, and that's another Triton feature, is that they've balanced their product very well. So it does ride very smooth. It doesn't do anything out of the ordinary, so it gives you confidence when you're towing. The only thing with the TC series, which is a sacrifice because you don't get something for nothing, is there is a little more fuel to be used when you do tow this trailer because of the higher height. Okay, so on this trailer, you can see it's staying tilted right now. That makes it easy for you to drive up and drive your sleds on. It will remain tilted with your sleds on, provided you don't drive too far forward. And it's easy by lifting the back of the bumper or pushing up on the cover to flatten this trailer out. With the ski guides that you see on it and everything and the traction, it makes it very easy to load. But again, the ramp door is an easier drive up. Well, what I find the most is a lot of people are intimidated by driving up to the cover tilt trailer and not going through the front of the cover because they don't have as long of an angle or as long as a stopping period. With the ramp door like this, you can get up the ramp door and onto the trailer and with time to stop. So now they feel a little more confident about getting it in. I think the biggest thing that happens to trailers, we all kind of understand bearings and tires, but what a lot of people don't understand is structure. And depending on even how you put a load in your trailer, it will change the lifespan of the trailer. A lot of guys in Northern Ontario with the rougher roads won't get the lifespan out of a trailer that somebody out of Toronto or Southern Ontario would get because the road conditions are just rougher. Now with the new salts they're putting on the roads and all that stuff, it seems to be reacting on aluminum or steel faster and shortening the lifespan. So, you know, you do need to wash your trailers in this summer. You really should protect them with some kind of a rust check crown product that will neutralize the salts and extend the life of the trailer. I find for us seeing a lot of trailers come back in for service, we find that anybody who's had their trailer inside, the trailer has about half the wear on it than one that sits in the backyard on grass.
No matter what kind of sled you ride, there are numerous choices and numerous options for trailers to haul your sled around.
It is one heck of a beacon and pretty cool to check out, especially out of harm's way in the air. It's the remains of the Bernier, a ship grounded in 1966 and the flag that says, "Welcome to Red Bay, checkpoint number 5. For most racers, they would not have seen the spectacular sights of this area located on the north shore of the Strait of Belle Isle as they expressed through this checkpoint in the middle of the night. It was a first for this community to be involved with Cain's quest. Team 17 had already passed through when we got an update from their support team.
They're doing good. Chris got a little sick there. They had to come back to the checkpoint at the crossover there just before Birchie, but he's feeling a lot better today. Looking forward to the 8-hour rest coming up. So now I think we got about 4 hours sleep since Saturday morning, so this 8 hours is going to be key for all of our team.
For racers at night, you need only fly down the coast of the Straits to understand the need for them to work the GPS for tracks inland as the sea ice goes from solid to wide open in many places. No shortcuts and definitely no place for a snowmobile as the teams leave Red Bay and focus on the target 95 kilometers away at Mary's Harbor. Team number 4, Backcountry Racing, made great time and landed into checkpoint number 6, Mary's Harbor first, along with Team 77, Backcountry Ravens, registering a tied time into Mary's Harbor. Making sure there was room for all to catch a proper rest, Cain's Quest regulated a layover split for all racers. The first half of the active race teams would take their mandatory 8 hours at checkpoint 7, Port Hope Simpson, while the remaining teams would have to take their layover at River Lodge Hotel at checkpoint 6, Mary's Harbor. The sunrise provided a sense of hope on the horizon. That hope came in the form of Checkpoint 7, Port Hope Simpson. first team to blast across the frozen bay and park their sleds in the compound at the Alexis Hotel is Team 4, Backcountry Racing, closely followed by Teams 00 and 5. As a layover, this checkpoint offered all kinds of insight as to what the run was like and the challenges the teams faced along the Labrador Straits.
Well, I wish we could have seen it during the day, but it was a good run. Good, lots of fun.
To be first?
Not when we got to say Birchie Lake. We didn't expect to make up this kind of time because we kind of had a bit of a misfortune today. Had to backtrack roughly 100 kilometers total, like 50k each way, to pick up a can that we lost for gas. And even though we got the can back, we still ran out of gas just before our support crew was going to be on the road there crossing. So about 6 kilometers out, so the guys got there real quick, got us filled up, and went from there.
Yeah, we had a couple of fool ups this leg. We were doing great. If we missed one key waypoint coming from Birchie to Lance Lou, we were chasing tracks, chasing the inner teams that were in front of us. Figured they knew where they were going. It was too late then, so we said, well, we'll chase them anyway. That was the big mistake, because they had lost their GPS.
The sun was coming up and rolling hills, it was all white and soft and fluffy snow. It was awesome. So that was one of those nice moments.
I almost forgot you were racing, right?
Yeah, until there was like 6 people with headlights in the background. Oh, I was just like, oh, I better keep pace. I can't have them pass me. I'm not letting them have it.
How are you?
Good, mate.
How was your night?
Pretty long. Been on the go since what time? Around 2 o'clock yesterday.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I don't even know what time it is or day it is now. Other than that, it's pretty good.
Well, it's Monday, my friend.
A bit of a frostbite.
You got a little frostbite?
Yeah, not much. Wasn't bad at all.
Pretty cool, though, when you see the sun rise, the sunset, and the sun rise again.
As teams prep to hit the trail for the next section of the challenge, veteran competitor George Rogers summed up his mindset quite effectively, leaving no doubt as to what he expected next.
7 minutes till hell, my son. Going into hell in 7 minutes.
The next checkpoint is only 185 kilometers to Cartwright, and the terrain won't be near as nasty as the racers once again hit the snow after an 8-hour rejuvenating break.
Snowmobiling is, of course, a winter activity, and with that, conditions can vary from extremely mild to also extremely harsh. Jonathan from Kimpex has some advice for staying comfortable when on the snow.
No matter your style of riding, layering is key to staying warm and comfortable. You might have the best jacket in the world, but if you combine it with a regular t-shirt, you're going to compromise your jacket's performance. This is a perfect example of a base layer. It retains warmth, wicks moisture away from your skin, also has an antibacterial material to keep you comfortable. The second layer is there to insulate you and keep you warm, while allowing ease of movement. As all of you may know, most of the heat escapes from your extremities. It's very important to have a good pair of gloves for your hands, a balaclava for your head, and a pair of boots for your feet. And don't forget to combine the boots with synthetic socks. Now that we know that we're comfortable on the inside, we need to make sure that no elements from the outside are going to come in and disturb our comfort. So that's where the jacket comes in. Being water and windproof, it'll ensure you to be always comfortable. And no matter the conditions, no matter what type of riding you're doing, if you have the right layers, you'll always be comfortable.
Whether you're outside for a long day of working in the snow or playing in the snow on your sleds, having the right clothing can make all the difference.
lot of people are, you know, they're getting back to the sleds that they remembered as a kid or their grandparents had. You know, it brings back a lot of memories. We have people that are buying a sled because they're, you know, their father had that sled and they remember it as a kid, you know, and so it brings back a lot of memories. It's like getting into cars, but, you know, a smaller scale, although the collections are getting bigger.
It can be pretty addicting, just like a car, right?
It's worse than a car in that way. I mean, our president has, you know, 120 restored sleds. You know, it's something you can do with the family. We're starting to do more and more shows, more rides, you know, vintage events. The White Court's got the World Snowmobile Invasion coming up in February. They're going to try to set a world record there. The vintage sleds are going to lead the parade through town and out to the river.
I guess it's a lot of work like anything else when you're restoring one of these sleds if you want to get it back to mint shape.
It's probably 200 plus hours of machine. The parts you have to source out, some stuff you have to make. A lot of times it takes three sleds to build one. There's some really rare ones. There's some common pieces. There's some sleds that are only one-off years. And
do you think this hobby is going to keep growing?
This hobby, I think, is going to keep growing. Every year we're getting new people. People are coming by and saying, I have one of these at home. You know, can I restore it and come, you know, on the vintage ride? Or, you know, we're starting to get some younger kids. You know, we have a couple members in our club that now that are 16 and 17. You know, so the hobby is growing. It's cheaper to get into than a lot of things. You know, there are definitely a lot of old sleds out there.
STV is sponsored by Ultimax Belts, performance proven, performance driven. Triton Trailers, the difference is in the details. And by CKX, wear your passion.
On next week's show, our test riders take out some trail sleds for first impression rides. I head off to Elka Suspensions to see how they work their suspension magic. And at Cain's Quest, the racers head up the east coast of Labrador. We love to hear from you, so email me, phil@snowmobilertv.com, and be sure to visit our STV website for our online videos. Thanks for watching. We'll see you on the snow next week.